I was born one of 12 children, 6 boys and 6 girls. One girl did not live for adulthood, to adulthood. And I think it's unique that my father lost an arm at 16 at the Atlantic Coast Lumber Company. And yet my mother married him, and she was pretty brave, I think, to marry one-armed man back then, you know, because what could you find to do with no, back then there was no workman's comp. And so I still praise her also for being a mother of 12 children. I grew up in not right in the city. It was about 5 miles out of town. But this was, Georgetown was town for school and movies and work, you know, groceries, that kind of thing. So Georgetown's been good to me all my life, still is good to me. So, and I've been in this house since 1970. And my very best friend came in and looked at it with me, and she said, "God, Nell, you're not going to live in that dump, are you?" And I dare say she's enjoyed the house as much as anybody else, you know. But I didn't let that deter me. I just kept on going. And I kind of restored it, maybe one room at a time. And so it's been real fulfilling. We're sitting here in the living room, and you mentioned a bead board. And that was popular back then, and we've tried to figure out how old this house is, and it's somewhere between 1920 and 1923. And the house next to me is also of the same style and the same arrangement, except it kind of mirrors each other. And I have 2 girls. You probably know my daughter Vicky here in town. She was at the Judicial Center now. She was at the Georgetown Times for a number of years. My other daughter is in Columbia, and she works at the University of South Carolina in the Guidance Department of Science and Math. My school was a little country school, Oak Grove. And if you go toward Andrews, it's now on the left-hand side after you pass the 9-mile curve, and it's made up into apartments now. I went there to the 7th grade, and then I went 1 year to Andrews High School. And then the laws changed, and you could go to any school in the county if you provided your own transportation. And so my father drove a school bus, among other things he did. And so we would ride with him to what we called a jumping off place. It was where the 2 buses, the bus from town came out, and his deposited the children he had picked up, and then they'd come on to town. And so I graduated from Winyah High School. And I had my 2 daughters, and then I went to work and clerical work. From then I went back to Winyah High School to work as a school secretary there. And I was there 29 and a half years. And the last 2.5 years of my career with the school district was down at the county office and the assistant superintendent for finance in his office. So then I retired and went to another job entirely. I started doing tours, walking tours in Georgetown. That was rewarding also. Our parents instilled a love of history in us. And you know, when my friends were going to the movie on Saturday afternoon, and mother were taking us somewhere to see something of historical nature usually. And I thought, oh, I'd rather be going to the movie. But now, you know, in later life, I realized how fortunate I was to have that love of the area and where we lived and the history behind it. So So it's been, like I said earlier, it's been real good to me. We had an excursion, they were called excursions back then, into town. And that we came to see Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And that was just magical, you know. And because movies back then weren't as plentiful, you might say. And that was a real treat for me. And one Christmas, one of my daughters gave me the home movie that I can, she said, this is just for sentimental sakes. So I was pleased about that, yeah. So, and we came to town for groceries, you know, and like I say, the movies. And usually I had a younger sister and a younger brother, and the three of us would usually come together to movies. And of course, back then, you know, they had a cereal, and you couldn't dare miss one Saturday because you'd miss out on the cereal. So now we got one of those things called on in the afternoon on TV. Soap operas. I don't remember as far back as the streets being dirt. My brother seems to think I should have, but I can't quite put that together. And but we always had a house full of people, and I can remember coming home from school one day, and as we got off the school bus, five friends came home with us. And my mother did not know we were bringing anybody home to spend the night. And back then, you had to really know where you were going, or your parents wouldn't let you go spend a night off. But I thought to myself, after that, I said, golly, she fed us all, you know. And Daddy would hitch up the mule and wagon and put hay on it. We'd do a hay ride. And, you know, you kind of did your own entertainment back then, which wasn't bad because you used your ingenuity to drum up these things. So it's, but we did have chores after school and before school, actually, you know, because we lived on a farm. There was a cow to milk, and there was water to draw for the animals. And so we had our regular chores that we did, and we'd swap off from week to week what we did. And if you really had something really special, you might be able to talk a sibling into doing your chores so you could do that other fun thing, you know. Ford's grocery store was usually the place that we shopped for groceries and hardware. And we got to know those folks real well. And there were other grocery stores, but that's the one my parents seemed to favor. And just years later, the son of these two men who ran the hardware and the grocery store, we'd been friends through the years, and he wrote me the nicest note, and he said, you know, I often think about your parents, and when they would come in, and he said, you thought it was an occasion, but we look forward to it just like you look forward to coming into town, you know. So that was a real compliment, and I kept that note, and I shared it with my siblings because I thought, well, they need to know that too. But you really got to know people back then, even though today you got all these conveniences, you know, like a dishwasher and washing machine. But I can remember coming home from school, and my mother was from a large family. Both of them were, actually, mother and daddy. But I can remember coming home from school, and I would find them on the porch, sitting and rocking and visiting and talking, you know. The sister would say 2 or 3 days, then she'd go home. So they did make time for each other, even though they had a lot to do and a lot to keep up with. My father was Edgar Cleveland Morris, and my mother was Docia, D-O-S-I-A, Anderson Morris. And they grew up in the same little community out in the country. It was not where I grew up, but another section of Georgetown, still Georgetown County. And mother was a homemaker, naturally, with all those children, but she was an expert seamstress. Some of the black neighbors around us would bring her the Sears Roebuck catalog, and they would say, can you make me one like this? And mother, without a pattern, could just, you know, just cut it out and sew it up, and they'd come that afternoon and fit it. And so I, excuse me, she was real talented in her own way. And she did quilting and a lot of other stuff by hand. And my father, like I mentioned, he did work for Atlantic Coast Lumber Company for a short while. And then he had the accident. And I mentioned his having only one arm. He was cleaning the saws. And it was a Saturday when the mill was supposed to be down. And somebody came in and cut a saw on. But you know, today they could have sewn it right back on. But he never heard him mention that. And if you'd call him handicapped, that would have been an insult. He could do just about anything anybody else could do. And occasionally you'd hear him say, if he put you to doing a chore, he would say, now you got two hands, you use them. So, but he could tie a shoe, he could put on his necktie. We just never thought about it. It was a cut off about his elbow. And all the grandchildren, as they came along, couldn't understand why he didn't have two arms. And they were going to buy him one, all of them were. And I thought that was real sweet of them, though. But he had a logging operation, and he worked my older brothers in that. And he also, I mentioned, he drove a school bus. He delved in real estate, just a lot of different things. And I heard him make the remark one day to somebody asking him what he did. He said, I'd do everything except bootleg whiskey. So he was out of that field. But anyway, he let us know that we had things to be proud of, and we should be proud of, and we should contribute something to our community. And I mentioned earlier, having been instilled with that love and your neighbors, you know. I've been with a lot of times to town, and he wouldn't want me to tell this, I know. But we'd make a detour, and he'd turn around and look at me and say, now, we don't tell anybody about this. But he was delivering groceries to somebody who didn't have what they needed. And so that was another good trait that we learned from our parents. I mentioned being one of 12. There are only two of us left now. A sister older than me in Charleston, and she's in a rest home. And she's just gone there in the last year. And she was still looking after herself and the house and the car and, you know, all that. And so she had a little stroke, and so her children decided maybe she needed a little more attention than she was getting just by herself. So, but she's adjusted and she's doing well. So she just had her 89th birthday, July 7th. No brothers left. And that's kind of sad to me, because you always felt like your brother was going to look after you for sure. You know, you had that camaraderie with his other siblings, but you kind of looked to them to, you know, if anything came up, they were going to take care of it for you. And that I miss, I really do. Last one died 2 years ago, June 1st. And he always came, and he stayed with me 2 or 3 weeks every year. And this last time I don't know whether he had a premonition or what, and he just said, well, Nell, I may not come back next year now. And I said, no, you got to keep coming. But he and I were very close. We had a good relationship. But then I'm fortunate I had a good relationship with all my siblings, I felt like, on my part anyway. So I was just back there. Now, one younger brother did a history of our family. And I was just back there now because I forget who's kin to who, and I hate to just say it off the top of my head because I may get it wrong. So I was kind of going over my notes back there, and but I can understand a niece asked me to do this, because with just me and my sister left, that I'm sure she wants to get it down before it can go anywhere, so to speak. But I hope I'm giving her the right information, but that's why I keep looking at my notes to make sure that I have done it right. But that was a great thing he did too, because it was time consuming and he didn't live here at that time. And he had two or three of us doing the leg work, and then he compiled it all. Do y'all remember Rennie Cathu? He was a character in here at Georgetown, and one day the Chamber of Commerce called me and said, Miss Nell, we've got a reporter coming in, and we'd like to ask you if you would take her around. And I said, well, where should I take her? And they said, well, we'll leave that up to you, you know. And so I loved Rennie, and I said to this reporter, I said, let's go down to the fish house first. And I was trying to fill her in, you know, to kind of prepare her. And so I said, now he's going to sit, but he's a gentleman. But always wait till he takes his chair, because he's got one chair he sits in. And she said, well, I'll just take my lead from you. And so we did that. And, you know, he came up, why aren't y'all sitting down? You know, that kind of thing. And so we told him that we were just resting till he got there. And so he was himself, and he used all these descriptive words. And so when we started to leave him, and she was a small girl, this reporter was, she looked at me and she says, I think I'm going to have to edit this an awful lot. And so I said, yeah, because he was himself, you know, that day, and he just talked on. But he's always a good one to start with, I think. You know? And I've missed him, too. And he always told me when I started the tours, the walking tours, he said, now, and then we had a horse and carriage back then. And he said, now, if it's too hot for the horse and carriage, it's too hot for you to be out there walking. So I always took my lead from that. So. And I mentioned working for the school district, and then after I retired, after 31 and a half years, I think it was, I approached the Chamber of Commerce about a walking tour in Georgetown. And unbeknown to me, they had kind of looked for somebody to do a walking tour. And I think one girl came into town from way out, about 15 miles out, and she would come in the morning. If nobody was there, she went back home, and that was it for the day. And so they encouraged me to do it. And I was happy about that, because it was really something I wanted to do outdoors with people. And so that was the year after I retired, I started it. I can't believe that was 25 years ago. But there again, people in Georgetown were good to me, you know. We would be walking along and they said, bring them on in the house, you know. And they let them see the house, and people just couldn't believe that. Well, first of all, they couldn't believe that you were spoken to. Because they said, good morning, we don't even know them. But I said, well, that's just a Southern custom. We just speak to everybody. I never forget one Christmas, I was doing candlelight tours, and one of the historic homes, the couple, it was a younger couple, but they were looking after the older people who lived there. And so they said, well, we're gonna be finished decorating by this Friday night, so bring your group in. And I thought it would just be in the living room and dining room and we'd be through. And they let them go all over the house. And they had decorations in every room. I make it sound like it's over decorated, but it wasn't. But the folks that I had just, and I said to them, do you mind if I bring, and they said, we'll have something for them, some refreshments. I said, no, let me bring the refreshments. And so they did, and they had them all out when we got there. And so that's the type of reception that you really appreciate among your home folks, I tell you. And I mentioned the churches, I think, where we started. And I was actually a Methodist, and Lloyd, my ex-husband, was a Baptist. And so I still went to the Methodist church. Then when we had children, I said, well, I'm not going to change my religion because you don't go, so we'll just raise the children in my religion, you know. But that prompted him to go. And so we did, and both of the girls were raised in the same church, First Baptist, and they have that good memory of us going as a family. And I think that's important, too. So, anyway, when Tammy comes home, she goes with Vicki and me, but we go about every Sunday. And she chose to come to my Sunday school class, which I felt like it was a compliment to us older ladies that she would join us. And but I think she's been real happy there. Oh, she knew most of the women, you know, my age. So it didn't, it wasn't a shock to her to go in and see people that she had grown up with in the church. But still, every now and then I go to the Methodist church because I can say honestly, sometimes I feel the need to get up out of my pew and go to the altar to take communion, you know. And I think that was one of the things as growing up in a Methodist church. I don't think you'll ever get away from that.
Is that Duncan? So,
at Duncan, yeah. So, and you know, back when we came along, or some of us, gasoline was rationed because it was at the end of the war. And my father would take a route in his school bus and pick up all these people who didn't have gasoline to make the trip. Or, you know, you saved it for something that you really had to have. And that was another phase that I thought was interesting, too, that they provided that service in through the churches. Joyce Mix and Gladys Cribb, Ada Jean Moore, Ms. Little, I can't think of her first, Lois Little, Lucille Kelly, Lynette Hines. We got a good group, really. And a younger girl now is teaching us, and I didn't know her before, Kay Poston. You might know Kay. But I've been involved in a lot of different things, the Historical Society, and I think I've been a member there since about 74, I believe. And that's been good, too. And I think we've accomplished so much just lately in the new building and everything. So, and I'm sure every day you have something else to explore or turn in or find or something like that you think, well, they got to have this, you know. So, but a lot of other people feel that way too, and I think we've got just a good cross-section of our local history here in that building. And the business and professional women, we used to have a great organization here. And it's like everything else, you know, people lose interest. And then there's so many other directions that they go in until they don't have time. And so it finally just fizzled on out. But I enjoyed that too. I miss it actually. So we'd name a woman of the year, do things locally to distress the women, you know, in business or in professions, things like that. And Betty Williams was another good one along with me at that time. When you think back, my girls used to walk home after school, and all the merchants knew them downtown, because like I say, you knew everybody. They would stop off and they would try on clothes, and I'd come home and there would be a bag of clothes on the bed, and you know, they had brought home something to try. You could bring the clothes home and try them and then take them back. And they would do that, but sometimes they would do it unbeknown to me, and I would say, well, no, we can't keep anything this time. And we just charged it, you know, they'd say. And I said, yeah, but when you charge something, you got to pay for it. But I thought that was just a good sign of a small hometown with the merchants downtown knowing the young people that came along. I thought that was just a super. And the other day when I was in the hospital with pneumonia, I had one of the girls that I had in high school, and she was my nurse. So we were talking, and I said to her, I said, well, I don't remember you going off and studying this right out of high school. She said, I was 50 years old before I went back and took my nurse's training. And she said, and you would never know this girl had lost two of her three children. And she turned to one of the girls, one of my daughters that was in the room with me, and she said, to my daughter, and she said, but wasn't it a good time for us to grow up in Georgetown? And I got to thinking about that thing, and I said, well, you know, they realized that too, how fortunate they were, and that's a good sign, I think. We had a neighborhood dog. It wasn't ours. And we just lived, on Prince Street at that time. If the children went downtown, you knew just where they were because the dog was right outside the door waiting on them. But he would milk the cow, and somebody had to keep the calf away from the cow, you know, while the milking was going on. If you fell down on your job, he would just take that tit and just squirt you right in the face, you know. So you had to be on the alert for him, yeah. And older brothers, I had older brothers, and you know, they were dating, and they would get us to clean out the car for them before a date and give us a quarter or whatever. I thought that was always interesting to see them get dressed up, because you just didn't think that these macho people were not gonna be slack about that either. And housework, now, I mentioned Mother being a seamstress. If she was sewing for one of us, we did what she would have been doing. You know, like cook supper or whatever. And so that was a good trade-off. We learned that it just didn't fall in your lap, that you had to contribute something while she was, you know, making your clothes. And of course, I learned to sew, too, and I sewed for myself and my girls forever. But I promised myself, if I ever got to the place, I wouldn't have to sew. That would be great. It sort of became a chore, you know. And I guess another thing, they would think, oh, got a date Friday night. You think, Mama, I could have so-and-so-and-so by then? You know, and you're working, and you have to just squeeze those things in. Yeah. But we would gather crops on the farm, and my father always said, you get the crops in, like grapes or strawberries or whatever. You pick them, and I'll sell them for you. You know, and you couldn't beat that deal because he'd already planted them and cultivated them and done the whole works. But that wasn't bad either. And this same brother I was telling you about, he and I would work together. We worked good together. And that worked out well. So we always had a little money. But if one of us had something coming up that we were going to take part in, the rest of us would kind of divvy up and give them that person spending money to go on the trip or whatever, you know. And it worked well because your turn came around eventually. So it was a good trade-off, actually. I'll start with the oldest and come down.
Just come down, yeah.
Rufus, Dan, Clifton, C-L-I-F-T-O-N, Clifton, Lucille, and Nana was the one that didn't live to be an adult. Annie Laurie, and my father named her that, but she couldn't stand that name. And she just finally dropped it all down to Ann, you know. Jack, Herbert, me, Nell, Ida, and Francis. And you know, back then you went to your parents' home on Sunday, and that's how you knew who you were kin to, because you know your siblings would bring their children and you'd bring yours, and you know, you knew who your cousins were and all that. I'm not sure that happens today, does it? I don't think so. I had a girl in my area, and we went to the same church, and often her mother, and we could go and spend the night with each other. Often her mother would bring us into town on Sunday afternoon and treat us to a sundae, a milkshake, but when the Sundays, she and I thought that was the only day you could get a sundae, was on Sunday. You know, on Sunday. And she didn't correct us because I guess she thought, you know. At Winyah Pharmacy, that's where she'd go. Even though I jerked soda at Walgreens coming up. And that was where the bath shop is today. And it's closed right now, I see. It's closed out. Yeah, after school, yeah, and on Saturday. And you know, they had on Saturday, they had a midnight movie. It started at 11 o'clock, and you got out about 1. And the drugstore on Saturday would stay open until after the midnight movie, which meant, you know, you were there, yeah. And then you had to clean up, so. Yeah, you didn't think anything about it, though, back then. I remember my mother going to Robinette's Furniture, and she always liked a wool rug on her living room floor. And we would tease her, because she would raise chickens and eggs, and, you know, sell the eggs and chickens. And we would call it her egg money, because she would, you know, we can do this out of my egg money, you know, like that. And so she would go to Robinette's, and that's where she got her rugs. And I remember that being the only elevator in town, but it was a freight elevator. It wasn't, you know, up and down. It was just to get you up to the third floor where the rugs were laid out. So that's the only elevator I remember coming up. And we would have our little, we didn't get an allowance, but like I say, we had means to make money. And when we came to town, we always waited till just before we left town, and we'd get our ice cream cone or a sundae or a milkshake or whatever you're gonna spend your money for. And the dime store was a favorite place. And it seems to me like that would work again, but I don't know. Well, I really didn't start to collect Coca-Cola to start with. But at the high school, we used Coca-Cola products because we had a bottling company here. And at Christmas time, they would send me a case of the small bottle of Cokes. And I put everything underneath the Christmas tree because I still believe in Santa Claus. And so the year we went from a bottling company to a warehouse, They sent trays and glasses and just a conglomeration of what they had on hand. And all that was underneath the Christmas tree. And my friend saw it and said, oh, we can give a coat, you know. And then a couple of articles came out on me about it, and people realized I collected. So, you know, I find it on the doorstep or on the bench, or never knowing where it came from a lot of times. And you would like to thank them, but if they don't leave the name, how can you? But and a lot of people don't want that. They don't want to know that they've left it. So I just accept it and just go on. And that's how it started. And then, like I say, it's just kind of taken a life of its own, really. And but that's been interesting too, because you meet such interesting people. One guy called me one morning and he said, I understand you have a Coca-Cola collection. I said, yes, I do. And he said, I work for Coca-Cola in New Jersey. Could God come by and see it? And I said, sure. So he walked in the door, he stood right there for a minute, and he said, I've changed my mind. And I said, well, that's okay. He said, I want to go home and get my daughter and my wife and bring them back. So you don't ever know what he got in mind, you know. But I've got a wall, the girls call it my tombstone, out in the backyard, that most people say it came from the bottling company. And it was given to me. And the person who gave it to me said, do you want it? And I said, yeah, but what have I got to do to get it? And he said, nothing, just draw a string across your backyard where you want it. And my man will deliver it. And they put it just as it should go. And then I got a brick mason to come and put it together. And back then, everybody couldn't read and write. And they could look over a business and tell what went on in that business. So they associate this with the plant here, which did bottle Coca-Cola.
Where was that located? Sorry.
On Orange Street, where that parking lot is. So kind of Han Kudzu Bakery. But there again, it's been so interesting to see what I know. That all this stuff was out there, you know, and a lot of it's just one of a kind. So I've been blessed there too. But like I say, it's just about to take of a life of its own. And Vicki said the other day, well, if you didn't have a Coca-Cola, you wouldn't have anything in the house, would you? And I said, just hardly not, yeah.